Mardi Gras. We have to talk about Louisiana culture and Mardi Gras. We can't not talk about this. Hope you, those chocolates good. You guys eat those chocolates? There's probably some more. There's probably more. You should eat some more. So we didn't put it. So in the king cake, there's a baby in it. So there's no baby in there. So you guys can eat those, wolf them down, and not choke. All right. Well, you guys are getting your Mardi Gras chocolates. Well, I'll start. And so a common metaphor for culture in Louisiana is gumbo. So gumbo, as you guys will see, is this. It starts with the roux, which is the base, which is equal part flour and oil. And you can cook it quickly. You can cook it slowly. Everybody has their own ways of doing it. You can make it out of oil. You can make it out of lard. You can do whatever. Everything has a little bit different taste. But and then basically a gumbo is you can throw whatever is in there. If you're a meat eater, you can do that. If you're a vegetarian, you can do that. If you like seafood, you can do that. So gumbo is a nice metaphor for sort of blending of things that maybe seem different on the outside, but when they come together, they all have a cool taste and they come together and make a neat whole. And so I think of Louisiana culture as a big gumbo. So this thing in the background is a famous place that you guys will see. This is Café du Mont, which is a famous place that makes these fried bread things that are kind of like donuts. They're called beignets. And they're essentially a fried donut that you throw powdered sugar on, basically. Café du Mont is one of the, so they claim this has been continuously operating for, I don't remember what it is now, 130 years or something. It's not true because during Hurricane Katrina they shut down for a little bit, but close to continuously operating for all this time. They're open all the time. They never shut down. And all they serve is our beignets, coffee, chicory coffee, which is kind of not real, the real chicory, but essentially that was sort of a boiled root substitute for coffee, supposedly, when people didn't have access to coffee and during hard times. Extremely bitter. So it's not my thing, but maybe you like it. And lemonade. And that's all they serve. That's it. So no matter how many times you go there and ask at the window, can I get some? And they're like, no, this is all we serve. So I actually don't think these are the best beignets. I think places like Morning Call have better beignets, but it's the famous place. We'll go there. Everybody goes there. This is in the French Quarter. And this photo is from the 1940s. Let's talk about the human history of New Orleans. And this picture here that we're looking at the top of this is a shot. Now we are looking this painting is painted from the perspective of being south, looking northward, right? And so we're looking across so here is the Mississippi River right here. And these old paintings and illustrations can be really telling, even though they're not, you know, a photographic history. They nevertheless can have a lot of really cool information in there, stuff contained in there. So what we're doing is we're on the southern side of the river, looking northward, looking at New Orleans. And so what you see, and then beyond it, that white stuff, that is Lake Pontchartrain. So that's the big embodiment of the ocean, just on the opposite side of New Orleans from the Mississippi River. And we see the original, this painting is from before the United States with the United States. This is the late 1700s. So we're looking over there, and so the city has been carved out. I think it's a good illustration of how it's carved out of the swamp, right? Carved out of this bottomwood hardwood forest. And then you also see there's a corridor, there's a path going towards Lake Pontchartrain. So that's a drainage canal. So that's a water, so bayou, that's a place that water that lands near the river can go that, because recall, this right here is gonna be the highest high ground, right? That natural levee. And so that's where people first settled, right there on the highest high ground. And then from there, after we filled that area up, then people spread to the less optimal areas and then the even less optimal areas and so on and so forth. You can also see, what do we see on the, so one, we see a lot of commerce, right? So there's a lot of canoes and things of that nature. We also see land clearing
on this side of the river, right? So what we see is we're looking, we see a few trees, but there's not that many trees, right? And we have instead are these slash piles. So here's some logs burning.
So before European settlers were there, obviously Native Americans were there. At least 10,000 years before present, our Santa Rosa Island Research Station is adjacent to the oldest known human remains in North America, which are, anybody know the date? Or approximate date? How many years ago? 13 and 14,000 years ago. So again, we can talk about the history, but so it appears that folks that colonized North America from Asia probably didn't go through the land Bering land sea bridge like way back when we were taught. They probably jumped over that in boats and navigated down to California and areas around there. Native Americans get to the swamp, within a few, probably 100 years, but definitely within a couple thousand years. Very difficult place to navigate, as you guys will see when we're there. Smushy ground, non-solid, roots that trip you, difficult to, say, run fast through. They don't have a lot of broad open fields, that kind of stuff. So a challenging environment. So it took folks a while to really figure out how to best work this place. But the key thing, the key reason why this area was so valuable to Native Americans and then everybody since is this giant Mississippi River, right? So this is a huge transportation hub. So as difficult as some of southern Louisiana is to navigate, the river is open. The river is flat. The river can be rowed on. The river can be followed. And so a huge transportation hub. Why is New Orleans where it is? New Orleans was a haul-out spot. New Orleans was one of the easiest ways, because the Mississippi is the main thing that Native peoples are using to move up and down and around. So over there, like Pontchartrain, so the Mississippi freshwater and all the freshwater critters that are associated with that. Like Pontchartrain, saltwater, ocean, right? So oysters, mussels, things like that are there. Saltwater fish. It's a very shallow lake too. So people that wanted to go fishing or clamming or oystering or whatever would like to go to Lake Pontchartrain. And so New Orleans was at a nice pinch point that it was easy to haul up your canoe and go to get to Lake Pontchartrain. That's why it's there. So when the Europeans came in and were looking for, and so again, if we go to the right on this image, we're gonna be flowing towards the ocean, yeah? So if we go right, we're bunching into the ocean. So that's where the Europeans came from. So they came from up from the right, up to the left, and they were looking for a place that they could establish a trading outpost that would be dry year round. So once we go south of here, like that's into what we now call Plaquemines Parish and everything, it could get seasonally flooded. So they were coming up, and why did they pick New Orleans? Oh, because some of the native folks they were talking to, like, hey, this is a great place to get off the river. So that's why New Orleans is where it is. And we have, and you'll see a lot of these names, a lot of these historical names are now the names of streets or thoroughfares or this or that. So we have Bienville and Iberville. This is the first camp, which again, Christian nations, right? So all this Catholic lore and everything. So they camp somewhere south of New Orleans. It's not New Orleans the first camp, but it's probably somewhere maybe around, it's unclear, but maybe around kind of where our house will be, where we'll stay in our house, but a few miles or more downstream from New Orleans. And they call it a Mardi Gras Point because they camp there on Fat Tuesday, right? And so that's what Mardi Gras means, Fat Tuesday, right? So again, it's the time when we're going to party before we have to go into our period of fasting and that kind of stuff. So they camped there. Bienville, relative of Iberville, formally starts it as a port, and they start going from there. Now, This is, does anybody know what the Great Game refers to? So this is European political blah blah. Stupid European, like, dudes with guns, basically, trying to be men, basically. And so the Great Game refers to some of this geopolitical intrigue between Russia and Great Britain. Long story short, there was all this jockeying for power in the European nation states at the time. And so one of the things about the New World that was seen as really powerful was there were all these resources that were quote unquote not being used, right? No, native peoples don't seem to count. Exploitation, it's all about what we can pull into our geopolitical thing. And so what happens is, it's not just some folks go, hey, let's establish a camp. It's, hey, we're flying this country's flag, or we're flying that country's flag. So then the New World starts to get divvied up into these different territorial claims. And that history is a key history with New Orleans. It didn't start as X and then become Y. It starts as X, it goes Y for a while, it comes back to X, it goes to Z. And so we have this constant mixing of cultures. And we'll see that reflected in the architecture, we'll see that reflected in the food, we'll see that reflected in just about every aspect of the town. And so, for example, right here we're looking at, this is a mid-1700s plan of New Orleans, what we now call the French Quarter, right? And the central, and so this is following a typical European city plan, right? So very regimentally laid out things, streets, buildings, etc. At the center is this thing right here. Which is a park, and it's all called Lafitte Square. And right here, there's a big church, because again, that's the center of the culture, right? Religious piety and all this and that. And then from as we go away from that, other things, trading ports and houses and things of that nature, and then originally surrounded by some kind of, in theory, defensible barrier, right? Because the evil hordes are out there, the wild man and all that kind of stuff. This is literally the frontier, right? So this is where the Native American folks are coming to mix with the European settlers and vice versa. Not a lot of support. And we'll hear about that in a second. Not a lot of cutting edge technology, shall we say. So a lot of problems happen. Problems in the form of diseases, because we have a lot of vector-borne illnesses, so mosquito-borne illnesses, before people knew that mosquitoes spread disease. We also have a lot of cramped structures, right? And so infrequent fires are a constant problem, where stuff catches fire and then burns, you know, across the town, such as in this case in 1788. As we said originally, Bienville, a Frenchman, this is a commercial operation, so we want to trade for furs with the native peoples and things of that nature. And I'll read you this quote from this one priest who describes New Orleans as a place of 100 wretched hovels in a malarious wet thicket of willows and dwarf palmettos infested by serpents and alligators. Right. So not a desirous place. So this isn't where the elite are going to come, right? This is where the sort of dregs are going to go, and those that don't have other places to go, that kind of a thing. And folks that are disempowered by society, that are looking for a way to accumulate wealth and sort of move up in society, et cetera. By 1722, the town of Orléans is a town in France. And just like we have York back in the UK, we establish a new thing, so we call it New York, right? And so this is New or New Orleans. And this becomes the capital for this holding. And very quickly, boom, a huge hurricane comes in, nukes the place, and then they establish this grid system. So again, even very early on, stress, disaster, change, having to rebuild, a common thing. We have the first major political change comes in the 1750s, where it goes from France to Spain. So Spain takes over. Now, all of a sudden, these guys are Spanish, right? And again, this is before internet, before radio or whatever. So sometimes when someone would win a war or lose a war, or a treaty would be signed, it might be 2-3 years before people figure it out, right? And so it takes some time for these things to propagate. And so Spain takes over Louisiana, New Orleans, and they get Florida and stuff at the same time. And so another key thing here is the Louisiana Purchase. Anybody remember what the Louisiana Purchase was? Right, but what he did? What happened? So Napoleon loved to fight wars. And he kept losing, and then he'd get, banned to Corsica or something, and then he'd come back. And so basically he was broke. Napoleon was broke, and he was desperate for money to fund his empire's war efforts. And so we have the very young American colonies that have just declared independence from Great Britain a few years before that, right? And France was our key ally. If France had not come to aid us, the Brits would have, walked all over the 13 colonies. So he says, hey, how would you like to buy some land? Or however the hell he talks, right? And so Thomas Jefferson says, yeah, okay, I'll do it. And everybody thought it was stupid. But he bought this tremendous, so this is my favorite map. This is a map on a sack of flour. And the shaded blue thing there is what Jefferson bought. Again, at the time, America is hugging, is squeezing tight onto the Atlantic seaboard. So they have very little idea what is west of them. And so Jefferson buys from the Mississippi River west, up to the Pacific Northwest. And this is where he gets Lewis and Clark and the core discovery, and he sends those folks out, and they go on an exploring, one of the great exploration trips in history, and communicate with many, many different cultures, many, many different tribes, massive, fantastic natural history. They see prairie dogs for the first time. They see giant condors. We know condors are in the Pacific Northwest at this time because they shot one. And all of that stuff. And so incredible discovery. But at its core, or the anchoring of this, is the Louisiana Purchase, right? It's not the Oregonian Purchase or the Pacific Northwest Purchase. It's the Louisiana Purchase. And so this is purchased for $15 million in 1803. Scandalous. People are like, this is insane. It's going to bankrupt our country. Oh, I didn't update this I lasted this in 2017. But that's about, $300 or so million dollars in today's dollars. So if you, it's shall we say, a good deal, if we're just talking about it. Right. Again, just to be clear, the French didn't own the land, quote unquote. They owned kind of the Louisiana area, quote unquote, owned, right? All the rest of it, there were native peoples living there, and they're like, who the hell are these weird guys floating up? Give me some medals. I'm like, okay, I'll take the medal, right? But so with all of that cultural problem and genocide and all that kind of stuff, this was an incredible expansion of the American colonies. Founded with all this stuff, right, is of course all of the problems that we still are dealing with in our country, right? So just this weekend, the shooting death of a young man in Sacramento has caused more problems and more tension. Ultimately, this is about power, right? And so this crazy land that these Europeans have moved into, it ain't a great place to do farming, right? It's a challenging place to do farming. It's a labor-intensive place to do farming. So if they cannot enslave people, and the easiest way to do that is people that don't look like you, right? Could be Native Americans, could be African Americans, whoever. That's how we're going to roll. That's how they figured out how to reap benefit from an incredibly laborious thing, which is growing cotton, growing sugar, these kinds of staples that were desired. So again, as I mentioned before, the initial folks that came in are not the elites from society. They're pirates, Jean Lafitte the pirate, and they're folks that can't, for whatever reason, make a living back home or what have you. And they're playing off that transportation. So that the very nature of having a big highway right next to the city, whatever the city evolves into, it's going to be a mixing of cultures because of that huge thoroughfare and bringing all these different people in all the time, new people all the time. Institutionalized racism and prejudice is key to the initial control, right? So there's not that many of the folks in charge that are trying to control a lot, numerically, many, many other people. So they use social institutions to do that, right? Those people are stupid. Don't let those people read. You know, all these rules designed to keep these folks in check and keep them down. Right. So by 1718, we have the first big wave of slaves starting to come into the area as the plantation system starts to take off. Interesting. You'll hear Michael talk about this. Unlike, we've said this before, but unlike everywhere else in the U.S., this legal code to this day is Napoleonic law, Napoleonic code. Everywhere else is English law. So that's why we have counties, they have parishes. One of the interesting things in Louisiana is they have a primogeniture. So everywhere else, the dude is the literal king, right, of the household, of the inheritance or whatever. But in the French way, it goes to the oldest female. Oldest daughter has rights and access and things of that nature. So even though we have this traditional system, it's a little bit different than the surrounding colonies, the surrounding territories, etc. Key date here, 1896, Plessy versus Ferguson. This leads to the separate but equal, right? So this is it's okay to have, this is again after the Civil War. So this is after supposedly we freed the slaves, right? And all we did was instill a different system that wasn't called slavery, but it was basically very similar, right? And so this is Plessy versus Ferguson. It's very interesting. So Plessy versus Ferguson was this public transportation basically in the town, and you know, black folks weren't supposed to be in this part of the car, and so a group of New Orleans citizens got together and they said, hey, this guy should sit in that seat. What's wrong with that, right? And so they did it specifically as a test case to challenge this notion. Unfortunately, it ended up codifying separate but equal. That it's okay to have separate seats for white folks, separate seats for black folks, as long as they both have seats, is the so-called legal argument. This is now recognized as probably the worst, or you know, tied for the worst decision in U.S. Supreme Court history now, and it's actually painted on the rotunda, this decision, to remind the jurors and whoever comes to the Supreme Court of the U.S. that, you know, don't get arrogant, man. Don't think that you're always striving for justice. You can be a tool of injustice. But that comes from New Orleans, right? So in the midst of all of this injustice, right, there's still this constant burbling. There's this constant burbling of people trying to do something differently, right? They don't always win. But unlike other areas and other territories in the U.S., there's this constant pushing of the norms, pushing of what's acceptable, changing things. And you can see this is where Plessy was on the streetcar. That's really bad. Sorry, you can't read that. That's okay. Short version is a long history of racial tension
right? Long history of going a little bit better and then falling back and going a little bit better and falling back. And it takes until the, you know, 60 years ago, basically, for that Plessy versus Ferguson, that separate but equal, to be overturned by Brown versus Board of Education, in that case, in the context of education. Okay, put that on pause for a second. Let's get back to today. Today's Mardi Gras. And again, as I mentioned before, this is the last day to party before Mardi Gras. So I'm drinking my last soda for you guys, because I have to get up soda for Lent. You're welcome. Yeah, as we said, Lent is a period of reflection and fasting. This is the last time to do something. Every Catholic region around the country has a version of this. So again, Brazil, we call it Carnival. Here in the States, we call it Mardi Gras. There's a Mardi Gras in Mobile, Alabama. There's a Mardi Gras in New Orleans and all Spain, all different areas. Now how this plays into our previous discussion about slavery and injustice and whatever, this is a party, okay? Parties are powerful, partying, celebrating powerful tools for challenging some of the status quo about what is okay and what is not okay, particularly if people are drinking, right? And a little bit out of control, right? And letting their guards down a bit, right? That's a non-typical thing. So part of, and again, as I mentioned, Mardi Gras is the day. Initially it was a day. Over time it starts to get bigger and bigger and bigger, and it grows into more of a season. Right now we're in this huge, the last, you know, couple decades, there's this huge season which goes for months. But the activities associated with Mardi Gras include things like wearing masks, right? So your identity is a little bit hidden, right? You can't exactly see who that person is. So that gives you a little bit of freedom, right? That may give you freedom to be an a-hole, but a lot of people are a-holes anyway, right? So this gives you the freedom also to maybe be cool, right? To maybe sit with that slave or sit with this mixed race person or whatever it is, right? And because it's Mardi Gras, maybe people won't say that's a bad thing, right? By the late 1800s, already the city fathers are like, those kids, those damn kids, right? And saying, oh my God, this is evil, and we have to ban this, and this is, you know, horrible, horrible stuff. And it includes things like, you know, slaves talking with owners, like that can't be, right? So the Mardi Gras as a source of fomenting change. So Spanish outlawed, every few years are like, we're outlawing Mardi Gras, and it lasts for like 6 months, and then it goes back to the way it was, because too many people love Mardi Gras. The various aspects of Mardi Gras. One really interesting part are the crews. So crews spelled with a K. And a crew is a group of folks that run a parade. And there's new ones being formed. There was just a story yesterday on the news about there's a brand new crew that's for folks of Latin ancestry. So especially folks that came into New Orleans in the wake of Hurricane Katrina. A lot of folks from Mexico that were doing rebuilding and stuff. They now have formed their own crew, and now they're starting to do their own parades, right? So another example of this wave coming in and changing. The crews and the parades were an attempt initially to say, look, we're not debaucherous. We're having a parade. A parade is a normal thing. So it's okay, was the idea. And then we have the balls. So there are also formal balls. And this is people in gowns and all that kind of stuff, but also people in costumes. So there's regal kind of balls, and there's masked costume balls. And so this is from Harper's Weekly in the late 1800s, and it's showing these folks dancing, and there's all these people in various costumes around them. Here's a street scene, also from the late 1800s, same idea. There's some kind of parade going,
on down in the middle, and this is before electricity, so we're seeing this is gas lamp lights, which still exists in the French Quarter. And so there's all kinds of stuff going on here. Check it out. There's a parade thing going on. There's a bunch of people sitting around, but there's all this other stuff. There's people selling things. There's this, it's this huge festive going on. As I mentioned, the Mardi Gras season starts with Epiphany and goes to Fat Tuesday. Crews have evolved. So crews sometimes host balls. They definitely host parades. And some of the old, there's like a zillion million of them, right? And some of the most famous ones are here. Babylon, Comus, Zulu, Rex. They work on their parades for, obviously, work on their floats and things for a long time. They work on their costumes for a long time. Many of them, and so for the costumes, like the big Mardi Gras chief feathered beaded costumes and stuff, they're handmade and they're made every year. And they don't get recycled. Well, I'll take that back. So they're for Mardi Gras, and then there'll be St. Joseph's night. And so there's like 2 days. And so, but other than that, they're done and they're retired. And then they sleep for a week or two and they start building their costumes and their parades and their ideas and their floats and stuff for the next year. Various aspects. And so here you see a float going by. So the floats used to be pushed by people, pulled by animals. Now they're mostly driven by, you know, a tractor or some kind of internal car kind of thing. And so aspects that we have are throws. That's what this is. This is a throw. And so that's literally something that was thrown. Initially, this starts with coins and then becomes chocolates. I just gave you guys chocolates, right? So the chocolates are another thing, little things for kids. And then they start to evolve. And there's all kinds of stuff. So if we're there during any parades, I don't know if we'll catch any parades, maybe St. Patrick's Day, maybe. There's all kinds of stuff. So you can catch a potato in the head. You can catch carrots. You can catch necklaces, obviously. So all kinds of things are thrown. And so sometimes there'll be frisbees. And so most parades, most crews have their own special things. So some throw coconuts, painted coconuts. And there's all these different traditions. And so what you do is you'd like something. And so what people say is, hey, throw me something, right? Throw me something, mister. And so they'll throw stuff. So one of the things sometimes people say is I'll flash you if you throw me something, right? And so that's where some of that comes from. But years ago, right after the Deepwater Horizon happened, our friend Harry Shearer, who normally meets with us, but he apologized, he's not going to meet us this year because he's in China. Or he's in New Orleans right now, but he'll be in China next week when we're there. But so he did this documentary, which I can show you guys, which is about FEMA about the Army Corps and the why New Orleans failed the way it did in terms of flood protection system. So the whole thing is about New Orleans, but it starts with a shot of, and so we had I did a symposium a few years ago here on campus, brought all these people from New Orleans here and everything. And so I said, hey, Harry, can we show your documentary before? He said, sure. So he gave us a copy. He's like, it's fine for you guys to show it. So thanks. So we showed it the night before. And then all these people are packing into Aliso 100, right? All these people, standing room only. And I was like, oh, we'll put the documentary on for 15 minutes while people are getting seated and they can watch it. And said, okay. And I hadn't watched the very, very start of it, which was a bad thing. And so I put on the DVD and pushed play. And the documentary starts with Harry Shearer walking down a street like this with a hat on. He goes, oh, you know, people think they know about New Orleans. And what they think they know about New Orleans is Mardi Gras. And then he cuts to the scene of this young lady. And so just as the provost walks up in the front and flashes on the big screen, I'm like, stop. In reality, the documentary goes, that's what people think. And that lasts for like 5 seconds. He goes, but this is what Mardi Gras really is. And it cuts to families and people, you know, in the real Mardi Gras, right? But so we managed to kill it just enough to imply that the whole documentary was naked people or something. So I felt it was really good. I did a good job on that.
The life that you showed in the beginning, I don't know if anyone caught that, but it was flat.
Yeah.
Right, don't ask, don't tell. Perfect. So so you don't need to do that. You don't need to, you can say, hey, throw me a necklace, and they'll throw it. It's just, that sort of induces sometimes people to do more. But anyway. So we have throws. And then we talk about the balls, and then music. So a lot of music, particularly by brass bands. And so you guys hear the term second line. So second line is a term that that comes from the cultural traditions in this part of the South. And so you'd have a wedding, or you have a funeral, or whatever. And so the bride and groom go first, walking down the street, right? Because this is a small town. We're announcing that this thing happened. Somebody died, or we're announcing that somebody's getting married. So first that person or those people go, and then the family come. They make a line, and they walk right after. The next group of people, the next line, are the musicians. So that's where the term second line comes from. And so it's New Orleans, and so these people are playing music, and so if you're in the wedding, you're like, oh yeah, I'm gonna dance to the music. And then if you're just walking down the street, you're like, screw that, I'm gonna walk to the music. And so then just random people will just kind of walk up and start following the musicians, right? So because it's a marching thing, it's a walking down the street, it's loud instruments. So it's brass, a lot of, you know, woodwinds, things of that nature. And so music is a key part of the parades. We'll just spin through a couple of these things because it's getting late. But a couple other things. These things are probably known to many of you, but just so we're on the same page. So Cajuns. So Cajuns are the descendants of the Acadians. And so these are the folks from French Canada that when the British try to take over Canada, they're afraid of these guys. They pick them up, throw them on boats, sail them down to the Gulf of Mexico, and salt and pepper them across and through the swamp. So they're afraid these folks are going to band together, form some big army, and go back up to Canada and try to kick their butts. So they drop 50 in this spot, sail another 25 miles, drop 25 in this spot, etc. So they sprinkle them throughout. They become the French-speaking Cajuns. So they're characterized by country music, which in Louisiana, country music is zydeco, right? So a lot of fiddle, a lot of accordion, washboard. So their food tends to be very spicy, a lot of peppers and things of that nature. A lot of rice dishes because they're in the swamp, and so there's wild rice that, you know, grew there originally. So rice is a big thing, and it's this dialect of French that nobody can understand unless you're from down there. I told you guys a story about, right, when I was with the guy at the store, and this crazy lady getting blue crabs. Okay, Creole. So a Creole is any mixed race folks, right? So Creole has different connotations in different settings, but basically it can be anybody, quote unquote mixed, quote unquote not pure, whatever the hell that means, right? So Spanish initially, French, African, could be Native American heritage as well. But really, it's not so much people per se. It's much more broadly a cultural thing, right? So it's the cultural parts that come along with folks from blended cultures. And so initially, it was a way to say that were you American or not was one of the early ways it was used. And it just simply meant that you weren't pure one or the other. You were a mixed group, supposedly. And so music, key musical things here would be slave songs. We'll talk about Congo Square in a second. Jazz directly comes out of the Creole heritage and other things. Food, again, rice dishes. The Holy Trinity is the classic signal of Creole cuisine. So Holy Trinity is celery, bell peppers, and onions. And then it's blessed by the Pope. So the Holy Trinity is a Christian thing, right? Father, Son, Holy Spirit. And it's blessed by the Pope. Anybody know what the Pope is? Pope has a funny kind of Pope hat. So garlic. So a garlic clove looks like a Pope hat. So he calls it blessed by the Pope. So a lot of garlic, too, in Creole cooking. And then and gumbo, we would not have, this is a great example, we would not have gumbo if it wasn't for, the African traditions. Because they bring in okra, which is a thickening agent.
right? And so it turns something from a watery stew into more of a thicker type stew. Food is real important. We're gonna, I know that you guys have some particular things. I don't like this, I like this, and that's all good. And I, you know, if you guys have lactose intolerance, I don't want you to drink milk, but I'm gonna encourage you guys, when we go to places, try something new, right? So everybody's gonna wanna try alligator, and so go ahead and do it. It's just, okay, it's not great, but you wanna eat it, so go ahead and eat it. But when we go somewhere, like, hey, what's that? You know, can I try that? Or maybe you guys are gonna get some, we'll get some sandwiches one day, po' boys. Maybe you're like, hey, do you wanna split one? Why don't you get that and I'll get this and we'll have it and we can each try. So I encourage you guys to try stuff, right? Yeah. Oh yeah, this is Coop's. This is Coop's place. So one year my wife was going to a conference after our trip, so I left her clues all around. So I went to all these bartenders people and I left her all these clues and she had to go hunt her way through Louisiana, and one of the places was Coop's. Okay, so there's John, a much younger John, many years ago, early on this trip. And we're at a place called Angels, and for some reason they had an In-N-Out sticker on it, and we were very perplexed as to how that worked. But so the classic stuff you guys should all try, hopefully, when we're there. Gumbo, again, that stew. It starts with a roux, which again is a blend of flour and oils. Jambalaya, rice dish. Po' boys. Po' boys are nothing other than a hero sandwich, right? So there's a bit of a controversy as to how they started, but the one of the most popular tales that they were created when some of the Pullman, some of the workers on the public transportation system went on strike, and they were poor because they were striking, and so these guys just sort of cut some bread and put some food in them, so they called them poor boys, or po' boys, what we call them. And again, all these things have a gazillion million varieties. So there's like seafood po' boys, there's vegetarian po' boys, there's spicy, there's savory, there's, you know, all that kind of jazz. Pralines, so a sweet candy thing. Beignets, those are the donutty kind of things. Red beans and rice, a classic dish to have on Mondays, but you could have it whenever. Crawfish, another key thing. We'll have a crawfish boil down at Foster's place one night. Again, because we're so close to the Gulf of Mexico, seafood's very, very common and very heavily. So the highest seafood consumption per person in the U.S. is in Louisiana. So we do our, those of you guys in coastal, we do our seafood surveys. And that one question is how many pounds of seafood or how many ounces of seafood you eat in the last 7 days? So when we had the refugio oil spill, we were doing all these surveys. I don't know if were any of you guys here then? We were doing these surveys. And so we're surveying this place in Ventura, and we finished up and we went to In-N-Out. So we're sitting there and we said, hey, let's pass around some surveys. So we passed around some surveys, and this guy was a cleanup crew from Louisiana. And he said, I assume he's telling me the truth, 50 pounds, he said. Like, well, I had about like 2-3 pounds a day. And he's like, why don't you eat cannabis? Oh, I'd say about 50 pounds. I'm like, no, dude. Like, in a week, just a week. He's like, yeah, about 50 pounds. So, so I don't know if that was exactly true, but clearly he eats more than the, you know, deck of cards worth of servings that most of us tend to eat. And then a lot of stuff is hot and spicy, right? And so if you guys are particularly sensitive to spicy stuff when we go to eat somewhere, just, hey, is this spicy? You know, and so yeah, right. And so some is really spicy, some is not so bad.
And so I've heard you pronounce it pralines. Is that how people pronounce it in New Orleans?
Yeah.
Because I grew up pronouncing it like pralines, so that's really interesting.
So almost everything here will have a funky pronunciation.
Okay.
So we say New Orleans. Post from there, say New Orleans. It's just a different accent. They'll know what you mean.
Okay.
So that's a great question, though. When you guys are getting food, hey, what do you guys call this? You know, and just have a talk with people. You know, hey, how do you eat this? Do you eat this just straight up? Do you put Tabasco sauce? How do you do it, right? So perfect conversation started. Ask people, how do you say this? I say it like this. I say it, you know, blah, blah, blah. Cool. And then there's a lot of visual art. So in Jackson Square, there's all kinds of, you'll see all kinds of cool stuff.
So there's places you can buy art in sort of galleries, that kind of stuff. There's little art, there's big art, there's all kinds of cool stuff. And visual art, another key aspect of New Orleans culture. This is a place, Gallery 940, where it would, and yeah, there's all kinds of crazy people there. A lot of vibrant color. Yeah, sorry, Matt.
Are we talking about the gypsy community that's there? So when I went at that square, they were doing art. There's a lot of gypsy demonstrations, and gypsy offering or selling their.
So you're talking about a tarot card readings, right. And yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. So there's all kinds. Yes.
Yeah. That's something that stuck out to me.
It's a tourist place too. So one, it's all this great culture, but it's also all these people, mostly from the Midwest, floating on through. They're like, "Ooh, geez, there's a naked person over there, right?" So there's the whole spectrum, right? There's the whole spectrum from folks that grew up there, from folks that love the drinking part, from people that are kind of like, "Ooh, what is going on here?" Right? So it's the whole thing, and so some stuff is catered to those folks that are like, what? And others are catered to the drunk frat guys. Others are catered to, you know, the whole spectrum of stuff. There's voodoo stuff going on. There's fortune tellers going on. There's musicians playing stuff. So it's, you guys will see a whole spectrum of different types of performances, different types of art. The robot guys that do the, you know, there's all that. There's people that will do your, draw you like a caricature. There's all that stuff, and so there's people that'll do a poem for you. Give them a couple words, and I will type a poem for you. You know, and then they'll type it up on a manual typewriter. All kinds of cool stuff going on. In terms of the visual art, again, all types of stuff. But one thing that tends to be a little more prominent than we have here is really some of our friends say New Orleans is the northernmost port in the Caribbean. So there's a lot of Caribbean influence in terms of very bold colors, very bright colors, and sort of juxtapose. So, primary colors right next to each other. Some artists have themes. So this guy uses monkeys, there's blue dog, there's all these different things. So some you'll see ideas repeated over and over again, or copycat artists will do a knockoff of them. And so on some of the art, people say, hey, don't take a photo, because people are freaked out. You're gonna take a photo and somebody's gonna copy it. But I think a great example of the kind of sort of gallows humor and kind of attitude towards life is the one on the left. So that is a Hurricane Katrina door that some folks just started taking these doors and doing art with. So when Katrina came and all the craziness happened and we got to get people out and all that jazz, how do we know if we got people? So first people going through, hey, is everybody okay? And getting out. We wanted to come back and check. And so this is a now standard search and rescue approach, which is with a can of spray paint in the building, in the home, in the structure, whatever it is. You go in, walk up, knock on the door. Hey, anybody here? And once you've inspected it, you leave a mark, right? Because again, massive disaster, same thing will happen whenever we have our giant earthquake here, it's gonna happen at some point, right? You wanna make sure that you checked in this place. So first you're gonna go through and check and see if there's anybody living, right? That's the first priority. Then you wanna come through and do another check again to see if there's any, maybe there's some dead bodies or something like that, but so sometimes you need to go more than once. So some doors will have more than, or some buildings would have more than one X, but what these mean, X, psh, psh, psh. Okay, so now we've divided it into four quadrants. The number on the right here, the 9/2, okay, so that was September 2nd. That was the date it was checked, yeah? The one on the left is the crew that did the checking. So this is, I don't know who this is. This is some team from Florida, probably. Probably Florida Search and Rescue Team 1 or something, right? So identifies who checked, identifies when they checked, and then the number of bodies inside is the bottom. So nobody was dead inside this one. There's also a place for other hazards. You can mark other hazards. But that's what it is. Very simple, very quick, but it became a very potent symbol of
of damage and death and all this and that. And so these people call them the Katrina X's are, you know, emotionally triggering for a lot of people and can be difficult to see. So what some artists did was say, hey, we're gonna take that thing that's a scary thing, that's a negative thing, that's a sad thing, and we're gonna turn it into something better. So they started taking doors and they started doing all kinds of, you know, cool paint on the doors or windows or shutters or all that kind of stuff. Okay, wow, I guess I'm at the end. How'd that happen? I'll just do a little bit of, so we did music last time, we ran through some of those songs. We'll hit this real quick and then we can break. But this is my super brief history of music as related to New Orleans. So this is Irvin Mayfield, who's a fantastic trumpeter and who is in Snug Harbor, one of the places we may or may not go. It's sort of a nicer jazz club. It's on a place called Frenchman Street. And this is a two-story place. We're sitting in the balcony looking down at him and he's playing the trumpet. Really, jazz only could have been born in the city of New Orleans. Jazz evolves in New York City and all around, and all this Chicago and all these great places, West Coast, everything. But really, it was born in New Orleans. So this is born out of this, again, this mixing, right? The Mississippi River, all these cultures and things coming together. New Orleans operas and orchestras were existing in the town. So you have formal traditional training, so voice training, as well as how to read music and play European instruments, things of that nature. Then we had these marching bands, right? So that was entertainment back in the day. That was how people got around in terms of military movements, et cetera. Minstrel shows, which we now look back as like sort of a thing, but clearly an important part for people honing different musical styles and things of that nature. Slave work songs were really, really important in terms of structuring music and structuring the sounds. And then in particular, percussion particularly from West Africa. All that stuff comes together and they mix, right? So they're mixing and mixing. Do I have an example here? Let's see if this will play. This is more a traditional blues song, we would now call it.
It was soon one morning, death come creeping. Soon one morning.
So this sort of aspect of the work song, right? A rhythm that's repeated over and over again to sort of keep you working. Either on a ship, it would be like sea shanties, right? Pulling up the sails in the field and cutting down the prompt or whatever. And so we have this sort of constant theme, but then we have lyrics that maybe are different, maybe reflective or about some sad thing that happens or whatever. Congo Square is a key part of this. So Congo Square in New Orleans, unlike the other parts of the South, in New Orleans, slaves could, not every single slave by any means, but slaves had, some slaves had the option to not work on Sunday and to go to, so it became known as Congo Square, so Congo from Africa, right? And so these folks could go there and essentially practice some of their traditions. So that could be religious things, that could be crafts that they might create and sell, it could be food, traditional food products that they could make and sell. And, you know, it was sort of a place where they could sort of be a little bit themselves for a short bit of time. If you were really good at making some crafts, or you were really good at whatever your biscuits or whatever it was you're making, and you could sell them even for just a little bit, you could start to accumulate a little bit of money, right? And that was a powerful thing. That was a rare thing in the South. And so this allowed these folks to start to accumulate money. And if they start to make some money, then they can maybe get a bigger pan or something to make even more or whatever, you know. And the idea is maybe you could start to save up to have a little bit of agency on your own, right? So to either get other things, or maybe even to begin to save up to buy your freedom or your wife or your whoever, right? And this became such a thing, again, just like Mardi Gras, right? All of a sudden it started to be a cool thing. And so then people that weren't slaves started to show up to see all this cool stuff and maybe buy some of this cool food and hear some of this cool music and this and that. So Congo Square really became this huge incubator type of thing. And it really became a place of melding of the European traditions of culture and music, and African musical themes and techniques and stuff. And so from that, pretty directly comes ragtime, that form of jazz. So ragtime borrows heavily from waltzes, a lot of syncopation, and this becomes popular music up until World War I. So this is what the kids want to listen to, kind of thing. And so the classic artist here would be something like Scott Joplin. And then we get to more of what we would consider the birth of modern jazz. The term jazz was originally insulting term, kind of like, this is a weird jazz, right? And probably first spelled with J-A-S-S. But regardless, we now call it jazz. And here's just a little, so you guys have the song. Louis Armstrong. What the hell's going on here? Jelly Roll Morton. So, piano, right? So, Jelly Roll Morton is another one of these guys that, hones his skill. Hones his skill in the red light district in Storyville, where there's brothels going on, there's bars, and the owners want to get customers to come in, and so they want to keep them entertained. So it's a huge demand for playing all the time. So these folks can, one, learn to become good musicians, but also, you know, 3 in the morning, everybody's passed out. I'm going to try some weird stuff. I'm going to try to make the piano kind of go, like, well, that was cool. I'm going to start using that, right? So a huge, and all these places where there's places to play music, you can make a living playing music. To this day, New Orleans, I've not really spent any time in Nashville. It'd be fun to go spend some time in Nashville. But there's not many towns like this around where you can be a musician, not have a record deal, right? But make enough to basically, pay the rent, essentially. Just playing music every night at a bar here, at a musical venue there, at a concert there, whatever. And so that tradition that started back then has maintained in New Orleans. And it's one of the reasons why there's so many cool things. So if we took something at high school, who are the cool kids? The cool kids are people that would want to be cheerleaders and want to be on the football team or something like that, right? That still exists in New Orleans, but the cool thing is, much more than elsewhere, is, hey, who's in the band, right? Who's playing trumpet in the band? And so this notion that it's a cool thing to play the trumpet, it sort of fosters people learning music, and then because there's all these places where you can learn, you'll see some kids, and we go out some nights, there'll be some kids just with tubas and stuff, like, you know, busking on the corner, birch, 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 birch. You're like, dude, why are you out so late? It's like a school night. You're like, shut up, dude, give me the tip. You know, burp, 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 burp. And so that notion of a place where there's always music, always demand for music, fuels people becoming better and better musicians. We've already talked about funerals, and everybody needs, and so here,
one of the things we have as a jazz funeral, which we now call a jazz funeral, but it's that idea of somebody passed away, and so we're first going to go from the church, or we're having the wake, we're going to walk out, and it's going to be a dirge. It's going to be kind of sad and whatever, and then partway through or halfway through, it turns into fun music. And then it's a party. It's a celebration of life. It's a celebration that we're sad this person passed away, but it's like, hey, let's party, right? And so everybody needs musicians for the funeral, right? Social aid and pleasure clubs, we talked about that before. Storyville, this is again the place where the brothel area, the red light district, and the shutting down of Storyville in the early 1900s leads all these musicians, are like, what are we gonna do? And then they spread. And so they go to the cities of the Northeast, they go to Chicago, and they take with them jazz, and that spreads jazz to the rest of the country. So the shuttering of that region of brothels really pushes it around the... And so again, remember Louis Armstrong, that first recording is when he goes up to Chicago, and so he's playing with the Hot Eights and stuff. So that's a friend of his said, hey, you come up here and play with us. And so that's how he got his start. Recording. That's how he got his start in recorded stuff. Okay, this is... Scholars argue this is the first formal jazz recording. So Freddie Keppard was, the first recording deal was offered to him, but he was freaked out. He thought if he played and it was recorded, everybody would copy him, and they would start playing his music back, and he would not be unique anymore, and he wouldn't make any money. So unfortunately, he did not get credit with the first jazz recording. It's this original Dixieland jazz band, bunch of white dudes. Now jazz is becoming popular and all across the country. So we enter the big band era, the swing era, etc. So we have stuff like this, like Frank Anderson. There's more dance music, right? So big bands. So think of Harlem and you know all these great nightclubs and things like that. And this is like the hip hop and the punk of the day, right? The old people are like, oh, scandalous music. What is this? Like, oh, grandma, you don't dig it. You know that kind of thing. Large bands, so large number of people. The radio is coming on into its own in this era, so now people are here. Even if people aren't in a city that has their own orchestra or their own place, you can hear this stuff. Like, oh my God, this is different than our previous music. And then it just explodes. So after World War II, we just start getting all these different variants and progressive jazz and Latin jazz and all these things, and just goes crazy, right? And so I think now a lot of you guys maybe think of jazz as kind of maybe an old, kind of an old thing. Like that's what my parents listen to. That's what other people listen to. But it's an incredibly adaptable format. And obviously other genres of music have sort of taken the mantle of innovation and trying this and that, but I just want to tell you that jazz is still very, very diverse. There is the kind of jazz where you sit there and you sip a wine or something and you listen to it, but that's but one small type of jazz, even though I think sometimes in our culture it's characterized as this, or some dude like snapping his finger, like smoking a joint or something like that, right? It's that, but it's all kinds of other stuff too. Just like all great forms of music, it's very diverse and it encompasses all kinds of innovation and cool stuff. And so our playlist, you guys will hear a smattering of jazz and sort of fusion and all kinds of mixed up cool things. And so we're gonna have a great time working on stuff, working out in the swamp, working, meeting people. And so the last thing I wanna leave you guys with tonight is to say, I'd like you guys to think about what you're most interested in. So when we're out there, we're obviously gonna be doing our work, our service and all that great stuff. You guys have to produce something after our trip, right? So you can produce a video, you can produce a poster, you can produce a piece of art, you can whatever you want.
And it can be on any aspect of our trip. So the key question, I'll remind you guys, the key question of our trip is why? Why did Hurricane Katrina happen the way it did? Why did the Deepwater Horizon happen the way it did? Why is recovery gone the way it has? Why do these folks make this food the way they do, right? Why? And you can ask any question. It could be an architectural question. It could be, or you want to explore the architecture, you want to explore the food. It doesn't matter. But I'd like you guys to think about what you think that might be, right? It could evolve over the trip. Like, oh man, I was interested in music, but now I want to talk about politics or whatever, right? So whatever your major is, whatever your discipline, by all means, use your training. But I would start with thinking what you might be most curious about and use that as a starter. So when you first enter some conversation with people, you can ask them about that thing and it might evolve. That's going to mean, though, as we're there, you want to gather some info, right? So you might want to jot down some notes when people tell you dates or names of people. You might want to take photos of the thing, photos of the church or of the field or of the boat or of the whatever, right? Might want to shoot some video. Maybe you want to make a video of that thing, right? And so we have to. When we come back after the trip, you guys are going to translate your experience to folks that didn't have the opportunity and weren't as lucky as you guys to come on the trip. So think about that.
Story map.
A story map would be fantastic. That'd be great. So what I ask you guys to do now. So we're gonna kill it in a second. If you guys need to go, you guys can just go. What I want you guys to do between now and when we leave, so 8 days from now, I want you to do a blog post.